praise. The Holy Spirit praying through him for the Ephesians, but also for us. For this reason, I kneel before the Father, from whom his whole family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray that out of his glorious riches, he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the saints to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now, to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus through all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Lord, your love truly is amazing. Your desire for us is unbelievable. We can't get our minds wrapped around a God who would love us so much that you would die for us. But you didn't stop there. As we read the prayer in Ephesians, you also poured out your Spirit, that your Spirit at work within us would give us the ability to face whatever we have to do, to be joyful, to be victorious in all circumstances, to be grateful in everything that we face, to know your love and to know the depth of your power and your strength, and to be used by you in this world to let people know about you. So God, as we gather this day, give us a fresh understanding, a fresh glimpse of all that you are and all that you do. Give us the ability to surrender more deeply to you, that your Spirit can take deeper and stronger control of us, that we will be able to see as you do, hear as you do, walk as you do, talk as you do, that we could experience the joy that surpasses all understanding, the peace that surpasses all comprehension, to live in this world not as victims but as victors, and that being joyful and peaceful, that others will see Christ in us. Lord, I pray that you would bring a revival and a spiritual awakening, not just to us, but far beyond us. That you would use us to reach those who don't know you and those who don't have a church home. And that you would provide all that we need, the resources and the people, to accomplish your mission. Lord, make us a family. Make us your body. Make us your army. And this day, speak to us so that we can grow in you and be prepared to enjoy the life that you've given to us. Anybody know what that is? Sugar. You like sugar? Yeah. You don't like sugar? Yeah, let's see what else is in here. Know what that is? Brown sugar. You like brown sugar? You like brown sugar? You like any kind of sugar, right?
He's not allowed any. None.
He's not allowed any. That's why you like it. See what else? Yep, some kind of powder. Flour. That's right. I thought flowers were like daisies and tulips. And... No? Oh, so it's flour from wheat, ground up flour. Not like daisies?
No.
Sunflowers?
No, you can't make flour out of flour.
You can't make flour out of flour? That sounds confusing to me. Let's see what else.
Rocks.
There's sugar in here, so you like it, right?
Yeah.
But you're not allowed any. You like chocolate chips? What else is in here? Mm. Know what that is?
Butter.
Butter. You like butter?
Only on your waffles? What do you put on your waffles if you can't have sugar? Just butter? That's it? Nothing else? Oh, a homemade whipped cream. I think this got sugar in it. See, what else?
Egg.
Do you like eggs? No? What if it's raw? I don't like this. And what will you do with it? Toss. No, we're not going to do that. And then we get this. And this. So, what would you do with all this? What?
Make cookies.
Yeah? Yeah? So we can make chocolate chip cookies. But we need milk and we need something to cook it in, right? Like an oven? Yeah. So, would you eat this all by itself? Wouldn't it taste very good? Would you eat this all by itself? You'd eat the chocolate, yeah. So some of these things would taste okay by itself, but not really. So, but if we put them all together and mixed it up real good, mixed it up, do you think it would hurt? You think it would hurt the flour or the sugar or the egg? Oh. And then they mix it up. And we could make it into a cookie. So, separate, they're not very appealing, are they? Mm-hmm. But you put them together, and you mix it. And you mix them up, and you put heat under it, and then it turns into a cookie. Now, it's kind of like all of us are different, right? Everybody's different. And if we're all by ourselves, sometimes we might do okay, and we might taste all right. But if you put us all together, then we really are good. Because some of us have some talents, and others have different talents. Some of us have some abilities. Some people can sing, and some people can play instruments. And some people ought to keep their mouth shut. Right? But then those same people might be really good with their hands. And other people, you don't want them to have a power tool within 30 feet of them. Everybody works together. And so God says, we need each other in our families, in our workplaces, in our schools, and in our church. Because when you mix us all together, but sometimes you have to stir us up and we bang against each other. And we have to work it out. And sometimes tough times come and the heat is on. But all of that combined makes us into something special. And it makes us into that. That is a chocolate chip cupcake.
Ooh.
Mm-hmm. Miss Sheila made that today. And that's my dessert. You're not allowed to have sugar. Sorry. Or wheat. Or eggs. Right? You don't want eggs, right? So you mix this all together. So here's what I want you to do. Make fists. Make a couple fists. And if you make a fist, can't do too much with a fist, can you? Except for punch and hurt one another. But if you open up your hands and you go like this, you can do it with, well, I won't make a whole hand, but if we hold hands together like that, and we can all work together and work. This is called being complementary instead of against each other. So, we're all different, and that's good, right? All right. Ready to go to class? Do you want the egg? Miss Pam doesn't want you to have the egg. Yeah, I know. Yeah. Today, I want to talk about the difference. The gender difference, and how do we bridge the gap so that we are working together in complementary ways. So, audience participation. Let me back up. Audience participation. Ladies,
Raise your hand if sometimes you find men to be confusing. You did that very quickly and with enthusiasm. Men, raise your hand if you think women are confusing. All the men look at their wives and go, is it okay? Yes, sirree. And there's been a lot of attempts to try to get a handle on this. In 1992, Dr. John Gray first released a book called Men Are From Mars and Women Are From Venus.
True.
And since that time, he's written 16 other books that are connected with that same theme, selling 50 million copies in 50 different languages. You think people are anxious to try to figure this out?
Yeah.
In 2001, Bill and Pam Farrell released a book called Men Are Like Waffles and Women Are Like Spaghetti. This book, in this analogy, the idea is that men are compartments, and they keep those compartments separate, and women are intertwined. Everything about their lives are just intertwined. Poet Robert Bly describes women's brains as having a superhighway of connections, and men have a little crookedy country road winding through life. And the list goes on and on and on. It's a hot topic. But the question really is, should we be talking about this on a Sunday morning in the church?
Yes.
And my answer is, what does the Bible say? What does the Bible say about this? In Genesis chapter 1, verse 27, it says, so God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. So we go to the Bible and we discover, yes, God identified. First, he says he created us in his image, but then he created male and female distinctly different from one another. So God started all of this, and so we need to have an understanding of it. First bullet point in your outline says, understanding one another causes us to better live Jesus' way. Because it's such a hot topic in our culture, for us as Christians, we need to understand what God says about the genders so that we can live in a better way, but also so we can help the people around us, so that we can be witnesses, so we can help other people see Christ in us better. Understanding one another causes us to live Jesus' way better, in a more fulfilling way, in a more cooperative way. Misunderstandings cause us to pull back for fear of pain. And God never wants us to pull back from one another. He wants us to live in complementary relationships, in strong relationships. Is it possible, do you think it's possible, just maybe on the outside possibility, that men and women misunderstand one another once in a while?
Yes.
Yeah.
That's not God's will. So if it's not, then we need to understand what God was doing when he created men and women. And it's not just in marriage. So I really want you to grasp this. It applies to marriage. It applies to our spouses, but even so much more. As a parent raising children, we need to understand the difference between boys and girls. For our siblings, we need to understand how to reach toward a sibling of the opposite gender. As we're working together and as we're a part of the church family, if we don't understand what God's design was and God's purpose was, then we will not be able to work together in a complementary way. So, let's talk about some actions that will lead us to bridging the gender gap. Number one, we need to accept that men and women are different. We need to accept that fact. We need to not buy into what many of the voices in our culture say, that we're just all the same and we could all do the same things and be all the same if we're just raised the same. It's not true. Audience participation. How have you seen little boys and little girls being different?
Yesterday.
You go in every way.
Boys play with trucks and girls play with dolls.
Yeah, boys just naturally have the motor built in them, right?
Yes.
Right? They play with trucks, they play with balls. A couple of these little ones around here, they're already... they got balls, they love the balls, and they're throwing the balls. Nobody taught them to do that. And the girls, they love the little fancy, petite kind of thing.
Yeah.
And
a
girl
will
dress Barbie and the boy will take her head off.
And use it for a baseball.
Yep, the girl will dress Barbie and the boy will take her head off. How does this work?
My grandson will take our house apart and put it back together.
Aww.
There you go. Grandson takes the house apart, granddaughter puts it back together.
Boys don't stop.
Boys don't stop.
Ever.
And girls?
Girls can calm down a little bit.
Okay, they calm. Okay. They are different from the time they're born. Now, audience participation. How have you seen teenage boys and teenage girls different?
They don't think.
Which one?
Boys.
Which one?
Boys don't think of danger and that they're doing stupid things. Girls don't think of consequences of actions.
Boys are willing to jump off things and not think of the consequences. Yeah. Girls don't think of the consequences of other things.
Yeah. In that regard, I think they are pretty much similar.
Yeah. They don't think of the consequence. Well, that's just an adolescent issue. What else?
No girls.
One talks and one doesn't.
One talks and one doesn't so much. You ask a teenage boy, how was your day? He says, fine. Ask a girl, how was her day?
2 hours
you
later.
You get a report that lasts days. Yeah. So they're different. We need to accept the fact that they're different. Now, in Galatians, well, from the book on page 63 of the Real Relationship book, Kate Millett says, because of our social circumstances, male and female are really two cultures. Mm-hmm. And their life experiences are utterly different. We really are. And not just because of our social circumstances, because of who we are. In Galatians 3:28 says, there's neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male or female, for you are all one in Christ. Now, this scripture says that we're supposed to be united. We're supposed to work together. We're not supposed to be clashing all the time. We're supposed to be working together. We're supposed to be unified. But the scripture in Genesis 1:27 says, God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. Distinctly different from one another. He intentionally created us in his image so that we have a soul, but he intentionally created us to be different from one another. And so we go back to the Mars and Venus, waffles and spaghetti, crookedy road and superhighway. Now, how are they different? I want to just list some things. This is not a comprehensive list, but this is just a list of some of the ways that we're different. And just as a disclaimer, these are generally true. There are exceptions when, you know, sometimes the guys don't fall in this category, girls don't fall in this category, but generally, as a population, these are true. The first one, we talk differently. We talk differently. In your small groups this week on the video, you'll see Les and Leslie Parrott talking a lot about this. And that is, and somebody even noted it for teenagers, is men talk to report and give information. Women talk as an experience of connection. And so for men, it's a report. Just give me the bottom line. Just tell me. I don't need all of the bunny trails. I don't need all of the I don't need to know what, you know, this person said about this person, I just tell me what you need to tell me. But for women, this naturally is connection. It's not so much information. And that's why for us guys, when we try to fix something, we make a mistake. Because it's not about fixing so much as it is the interaction, the connection, the experience. We emote different. We have different kinds of emotions. For men, the accepted emotion is anger. For women, it's much more about the emotions that vary. So crying easily, laughing more easily, just a lot of different, and guys don't even know what they're feeling, and women feel everything. We try to control differently. And this goes back what happened in the garden when Adam and Eve sinned. Before, in the garden, it was perfect relationship with God, perfect relationship with one another. But when sin came in, sin caused us to try to get our way, but we do it differently. For men, we try to force things. For women, it's manipulation, trying to make it happen without this confrontation. It kind of went like this. When our kids were younger, my oldest son, you never had to wonder what he was thinking. Because when he didn't like something, he would just get in your face and he'd tell you you're stupid and you're wrong and I'm going to do what I want to do and you ought to get out of my way because I'm right and I'm always right. When I would tell the girls to do something, they would shake their head and say yes, and then they would go do what they wanted to behind my back. They were both doing the same thing, doing what they want to do. We just tend to do it in different ways. Am I making you mad yet?
No.
We feel loved differently. We feel loved differently. Willard Harley, in his book, His Needs, Her Needs, identifies that there's 10 basic love needs, intimate needs. And the challenge is the top five for men are the bottom five for women. Mm-hmm. And the top five for women are the bottom five for men. We're opposite. So for men, physical intimacy, companionship, having a wife that prepares herself to look good for him, a peaceful home, and admiration. For women, it's conversation, affection, honesty and openness, feeling secure financially, and a family commitment from her husband. Now, we all have all 10 of those, but we have their opposite. We feel love differently. We see differently. We see the world differently. Men tend to be big picture, abstract, you know, spatially, ability to see spatial things. Women, it's much more details, concrete, intuitive. Sitting at a restaurant, and Sheila and I are there, and Sheila will say, did you see the way the waitress looked at me? Oh, there was a waitress? We just see differently. We just say differently. We think differently. We think differently. And this comes out of the book on page 65. They report that research is now being forced to recognize that men and women are created differently. That the male and female brains were created differently. But not only that, the male men and women use their brains differently. They perceive reality differently. And so we think differently. Men, and so the first action we need to take is to accept, to truly accept that men and women are different. I want to show you a video clip by my friend Ken Davis, his take on some of this.
Oh, no.
I hate this.
Come on. Been giving me problems all morning. Oh, come on. We will bring it into small. It
enter if it works.
No. Oops, no. Well, I can go back and pick the wrong one.
Here's another thing they tell you that's backwards, and I'm going to back it up. I'm going to turn it around. I'm going to rewind it for you. No matter what anybody has told you in the past, here's the truth from Ken Davis. Men and women are different. We are different. God made us different so we could get along with each other. So that life would be more fun. And now that I got your attention, ladies, may I ask a favor of you? This is my chance to try and help you understand where we're coming from. If you have something to say to us, say it! Don't put it in the form of a question we can't answer. Every man in the room now going, oh, brother, preach this. Preach this. We are paralyzed. From the moment we become married, we begin to be asked questions for which there is no answer. And we begin to freeze because we want to give the right answer, but there is no right answer. Son, what was your name? Right back there, what is your name again? Aaron, I'm going to teach you some lessons here that will serve you well for the rest of your life. The first thing I want to tell you, son, is this, that I've been married for 35 years to the same woman, and I love her more than anything on the face of the earth, but she needs to be put away. Listen to me, son. You know, don't you think for a second I'm mocking her. I am not mocking her, because the day they come in that white truck to pick her up, I'm crawling in the back with her, because I don't want to live with anybody else. I don't want to be with anybody else. I love her. But she asked me questions. I'm in this beautiful suite they have provided for us. There's a fruit bowl in there you can't get into. It's wrapped in plastic. The only way you can get through that plastic is with a blowtorch. So I called down to the front desk, and they sent up a maintenance man. And he opened the fruit basket, and it was so huge and wonderful, I thought I would show it to my wife. And I came out of the room where the fruit basket was, the little kitchenette, and I moved into that main room there. And just as I moved into that main room, I stumbled on the rug, and I fell, and the fruit went everywhere. She was standing in the doorway of the bedroom. And she said, "Why'd you do that?" I began to freeze. I've been married for 35 years. I know there is no answer to that question. What am I going to say? I wanted to count them. I didn't know how many there were, and some were underneath. So. If I'd have said that, she'd have whacked me so hard with that pan. The other day she said to me, "Are you leaving the house looking like that?" There is no answer. If I say no, I don't get to go where I'm going. If I say yes, I die. Why doesn't she just say to me, "Sweetheart, if you're going to leave wearing those two colors in the same general area, you need to hire a referee." Someday, son, your wife is going to come home. She'll be shopping. She's shopping. And she'll come home and she'll walk in the front door. She'll say, "I bought this today."
No, no goodness.
What do you think of it? Do not say a word. God is a wonderful God, and He created us as absolute idiots. We do not know the answer to that question. What do you think of this? "Oh, I tried, son, I tried." I said, "Oh, it's fine." "You don't like it?" "No. It's fine, it's really fine." "What's wrong with it? Why wouldn't you like it?" "Honey, it's fine." "What do you want me to say?" "If you thought it was fine, if you thought it was beautiful, you would say, 'That makes you look beautiful, and it makes me desire you.'" I was so happy. I had the answer. If I said to her, sweetheart, that dress makes you look beautiful, and I desire you. She said, you're just saying that because I told you. And son, if your wife ever comes in and says, does this dress make me look big? Run!
Well, let me see your hand if you thought that was funny. One of the indications, and this is in your outline, one of the indications that we truly accept and value the differences is when we're able to laugh together. Not laugh at each other, not complain about each other, but to laugh together. And the reason why all of these folks and all of you were laughing so hard is because it's true, it's reality, right? And we can either get angry about it, or we can just laugh together about it. Now, it's kind of politically incorrect to do all of this, to say all of this. And so there's a little bit of angst and wondering if people are going to get mad when we start talking about the differences. But we need to accept that we are different and understand that's the way God made us. So that we can live fuller lives. Number two, after we accept that we are different, we need to seek to understand from the other person's angle, from the other's angle. So to accept it is to say that we're different, but then everything as a Christian we need to be doing is to understanding others so that we can reach toward them. Not to label them, not to discount them, but to constantly be reaching towards so that we can work together. Is it a sadistic bad joke by God to make men and women so different and so difficult to understand each other? No. It's a gift. It wasn't always like this. He did make us different from the beginning. But it wasn't always like this that we misunderstood. Back in the garden, Adam and Eve understood each other perfectly. But then they got along perfectly. They understood each other perfectly. They enjoyed complementary relationships, working together. There was peace between them. There was never any conflict, angst. There was differences, I'm sure, that they had to work through, but they always worked through it well. Until they thought they knew better than God. And that's what gets in the way. That's what sin is. Deciding we know better than God, and I'm going to do it my way. I'm going to be the boss. I'm going to choose my own way. And it went from perfect, complementary, peaceful relationship to confusion and trouble. So a part of what Jesus did when he died on the cross and sent his Holy Spirit is give us the ability to begin to restore our understanding so that we can reach toward one another, love each other better, and work together well. We need to strive and work hard to put ourselves into the other person's place, understanding where they are. And that requires communication instead of assumptions, is to communicate well. It requires that, if we go back a couple of weeks, that we find our completeness in Christ. Because if we're not complete in Christ, we're always going to be wanting something from the other person. It's about understanding one another so that we can love that other person, but also so we can serve Christ better. So understanding one another in the body of Christ, understanding the differences, putting ourselves into the other person's place, so that we can more completely be the body of Christ rather than conflicting with one another. In Matthew chapter 7, verse 12, Jesus says, so in everything, do to others what you would have them do to you. For this sums up the law and the prophets. Do to others what you would have them do to you. Tony Alessandra has come up with something he calls the platinum rule that says, treat others the way they want to be treated. And I really think that's what Jesus meant, is put yourself in the other person's place. Don't meet their needs like you want your needs met. don't expect what you want others to expect of you, but reach into the other person's life, heart, and mind and find out what it is that they want. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 33, in the context of marriage, the Holy Spirit speaking through the Apostle Paul even identifies how we're supposed to relate to each other in marriage in different ways. He sums up a section that talks about it in Ephesians 5:33 and says, however, each of you also must love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband. He doesn't say, love husbands, love your wives, and wives, love your husbands. He says, husbands, love your wives, treasure them, cherish them, and wives, respect, admire, respect your husbands. See, he understands we have different needs, different ways of feeling loved and cared. And in fact, there's a, you know, in addition to the other ones that I talked about, there's a whole seminar on love and respect. Women need love, men need respect. In the book on page 66, Henry Ford says, if there is any one secret of success, it lies in the ability to get the other person's point of view and see things from that person's angle as well as from your own. Henry Ford. I don't know that he was a Christian. And then from the great theologian Dave Barry. He's a comedian. Well, here's what women want. To be loved, to be listened to be desired, to be respected, to be needed, to be trusted, and sometimes just to be held. What men want? Tickets to the World Series.
Yep.
It's a funny way of saying we need different things. Now, I put a couple bullet points in there. Insecurity, if we are not complete in Christ, if we are insecure, if we get defensive, we will want others to be like us. And that's what happens with kids when they're little. Somebody different comes in, and because of the insecurity, they make fun of that person that's different. And we do it as adults, we just do it in different ways. But when we get secure, when we get secure in Christ, when we really have found completion in Christ, we will be able to celebrate our differences. We don't need other people to be like us. In fact, we don't want other people to be like us. We want us to work together. Differences either cause division when we are insecure, or they cause a sense of oneness and unity when we are secure. Then number three, we need to live complementary for the highest good. Live complementary for the highest good. So we accept that men and women are different. We seek to understand from the other person's angle. And now we do all within our power to live complementary. Genesis 1:27. God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. He created us to live complementary. Jesus offers the ability through the power of his Holy Spirit to regain and restore a portion of what was lost in the garden. To restore and enjoy the kind of complementary relationship that Adam and Eve had. But it requires us to look to Jesus and surrender to him. It's kind of like what I did with the kids. Everybody take your hands and make fists. Now there's not a whole lot you can do with a fist. You can hurt something. Fist really is a symbol of power. It's a symbol of violence. But if we open our palms, open our hands like this to Jesus and say, okay, I surrender to you. I want to live the way you want me to. Now we can live complementary. We can join hands. You can't join hands with other people if you have fists. That's what complementary means. It's being different, but being united in one. And we have to work hard at that because sin will always cause us to divide. Sin will always cause us to divide. And that's the next bullet point. Sin divides, but love unites. And love means working hard to live complementary, working hard to work together. A thought occurred to me as I was preparing this, and I think it came from the Holy Spirit. The physical oneness of a married couple in sexual union is the outward symbol of all that God wants to happen in the relationship. The physical oneness of sexual union is the outward symbol of all that God wants to occur in the relationship, in the heart to heart, the mind to mind. But in our culture, it has become the point. It has become the focus. It has become first, rather than the epitome of what God has to offer. God wants us to unite. He wants us to be complementary. Sin divides, but love unites. Genesis 2:18, the Lord God said, "It is not good for the man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him." So Adam, at that point, is all by himself. There's no one, no other human being for him. And God says, it's not good, but we need one another. And then he said, "I will make a helper suitable for him." Now, suitable literally means corresponding to. Corresponding to, complementary, opposite of. And helper means supplying what is lacking. And it was meant to go both ways, not just for Adam, but also for Eve. So when he's saying this, he's saying, I make them different. I'm making them different so that they could complement one another. In sinfulness, we clash, but in love, we unite. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 4 to 7, it says, there's one body and one spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. In other words, we need each other. God has created us differently, men and women as well, as different skills, different abilities, different talents, different experiences, different ways of thinking. When my oldest son, Andrew, had been married about a year and a half, and we went down to Atlanta to visit him. And he and his oldest sister didn't get along when they were younger. Surprise, surprise, right? And so we were all down there, and after we were there a couple of days, they just lived in this two-bedroom apartment, so some of us were sleeping in a bedroom, others were just camped out in the little living room they had. And after a couple of days, Andrew and Carissa got into it. And Andrew just got so mad, he didn't know what to do. He jumped up, he screamed, and he went into his bedroom and slammed the door. And Sarah, his wife of a year and a half now, in her very gentle way, stood up and went over to the door that he had just slammed, opened the door, looked in, said something to Andrew, and then turned back to us as she said, "We're just going to leave this door open because that's not the way we're supposed to act." And then she went in and there was a conversation that we didn't hear, but it wasn't long until Andrew came out apologizing and making it right. Now, that's what it means to be complimentary. What Sarah needs, his heart, you know, his ability to plan and organize and lead, but he needed her gentle spirit of understanding and people skills. And they have both become better people because of the influence, but they are very opposite from one another. Now, that happens in marriage, but it also ought to happen in the context of the church. Instead of being fearful and defensive, and when things go wrong and we have conflict, you know, you can't make those chocolate chip cookies unless you stir it up. And so when it's stirred up, it's painful, it hurts, it's not very comfortable. And then you can't make it unless you put some heat under it. And that's not very comfortable either. But that's what's required. And so we have to stay engaged. We can't bail out. We have to say differences are a gift from God. And we're going to work at it. We're going to do all we can to understand one another. And then we're going to do all we can to work complementary. Then Romans chapter 12. Just as each of us has one body with many members, and these bodies do not have all the same function, so in Christ, we who are many form one body, and each member belongs to all of it. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another. Be devoted to one another. In brotherly love, honor one another above yourselves. It's about working hard at meeting people where they are and working together. All of us have relationships of the other gender. Spouses, siblings, parents, children, co-workers, and fellow brothers and sisters in the body of Christ. We need to be able to work together. Forget about being politically correct. Understand, just let's just laugh together and enjoy the differences that we have to each other, but let's work hard in helping one another bridge the gender gap. In small groups and in the chapter for this week in Real Relationships, we're going to talk more about how we can do this. But by doing it, let's be an example to the world of this is how you really love. Would you bow your head? As we've talked today, are there any actions that you need to take? Maybe there's a sibling, or maybe a spouse, maybe a parent or a child, that you've been trying to get them to relate as you relate. You've been trying to make them come your direction. And now after we've talked, you realize you need to reach toward them instead. Any changes you need to make, any relationships you need to work on. As the people of God, I challenge you to do that. Lord, all that you created is good. And so we're so grateful that we serve the all-wise God who knew what he was doing when he created us different. Lord, help us to value those differences. Not be like the world who mocks or makes fun or degrades, but rather honors and lifts up or respects and strives to love. Father, I pray that you convict us of any relationships where we need to work on to bridge that gap. I pray for the marriages that are in this congregation that, God, you would make them stronger and stronger as they strive to understand and celebrate those differences. And God, help us to be better examples to the world because we are committed to this. I pray that you would be in the small groups this week, that you would help them to laugh a lot and enjoy the kinds of things that they talk about, but also to help and encourage one another and come away strengthened and focused on you. In the name of Jesus, we pray.
October is always Pastor Appreciation Month, and every year we try to do something a little bit different. First of all, I'll give you the scriptures that support and encourage this event. In Timothy 5, verse 17, it says, "The elders who direct the affairs of the church well are worthy of double honor, especially those whose work is preaching and teaching." And in Hebrews 13:7, it says, "Remember your leaders, those who spoke the word of God to you. Consider the outcome of their way of life," excuse me, "and imitate their faith." So today we want to honor you in true New Song fashion. Now, I can't speak for everyone, but my family is on the fourth generation of belonging to New Song. And when I first met Pastor Herb, he looked like this. But after years of putting up with us, he looks like this. Sorry about that, Herb.
Yeah, sorry.
Talk about change lives, right? Okay, but seriously, you've impacted our lives in dramatic ways with your preaching and teaching, your counseling, your friendship, and your prayers. You've shown many of us how to move from just knowing about God to knowing God's presence in our lives. And your Holy Spirit-filled counseling has saved relationships and taught us some really important lessons. Your example has illustrated a life of integrity and humility, and we've been able to follow your lead without being afraid of being misled. And we appreciate you. We want you to take a seat, like if you'll move a chair around, David, and face the congregation for a moment. Yeah. Now, therefore, since our pastor commits his time and energy into prayer and guiding us to be fully devoted disciples of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, we proclaim the following. And if you guys will read along with me. That we will honor your calling and will respond to your biblical teaching. That we will serve with you in the Great Commission. That we will practice total life stewardship with you. That we will stand with you during difficult times,
that we will work side by side with you in ministry, that we will refresh you through words of appreciation, respect, and encouragement, that we will stand with you as a united church family so that your job will be a joy and not a burden, that we resolve to lift you up in prevailing prayer. This is our proclamation to you with thanks and appreciation for all that you do. Now, before we go any further, I want to mention for those who are not aware that we do have pastor prayer partners. What they are, if you want to put on the back of the blue card that you'd like to be one, I can give you more information. Twice a month, we get a list from Pastor Herb of things that he would like us to pray personally for. And you just commit to one day a week doing that. And now, before we give you your gift, we're going to have EJ and David come up and pray over you, and the rest of you can bow your heads and agree in prayer.
All right. Bow with me. If you want to reach out your hand too, that's fine too. Father God, we lay our hands today on a man that you have turned into a great man, you have impacted and are using every day, Lord. And today we want to lift him up and appreciate him for the work that he has done for you and the work he continues to do so faithfully, Lord. Today particularly, Lord, I want to pray for his health, Lord. Give him that strength through small colds, big colds, serious injuries, whatever it be, Lord. They will likely come. They will be that fire you use to continue to mold him, but at the same time, we pray that you give him the strength and give us the dedication and commitment to pray for him, to help him in those areas, Lord, in his physical well-being, Lord, in his emotional and spirit, in his relational, Lord. We are many of the relationships that he interacts with, and there are many others outside, and we pray that we're encouraging to him, and we thank you for so much that he's done for each one of us. Pray that you will give him the continued patience with all of us and the other relationships he interacts with, Lord. We appreciate his steadfastness in going forth and having those relationships, Lord. With his emotions, Lord, we pray that you give him peace, calm, resolve to continue to do those important works that you have for him, and that we support him in those areas and are able to give him the words that you give us to give him, Lord. We are a family, and we want to lift him up, Lord, in what we do and say. Lord, we pray that you continue to fill him with the joy and humor and love that you have for so long now, Lord, and that we all have grown to appreciate. And that's why, you know, we come here to praise and worship you, but we also come here to be around each other. And Herb is just the center of that, that you've just given him so much love, joy, and peace, Lord, that we just want to be a part of that. We thank you so much for him in that role, Lord.
Holy Heavenly Father, I'd like to start with saying that you always were, or always am present, and will be here, entity, eternity, forever. You created us. You created us from dirt and put life into us, your life. You made us in your image. We have souls. And I start with that because we need to be focused on the fact that life is fleeting. It doesn't last very long. We might think that 70, 80, 100 years is a long time, but it's nothing for you. You are eternity, and you created us so that we could be aware that there is eternity and be aware of you and that your spirit exists. And that's why we come here, for spiritual nourishment. And we need a good teacher and a good leader and a good holy man, a man who is filled with your spirit, who wants very much to not only himself and for his family be one in spirit with you, but who wants to share that, who wants that to grow within his extended family, within his holy family, his church family here at New Song, with all of the people in the world, in the community, and further out, even to the point of international, in whatever way we can touch people's lives. He supports what we're doing with the Christmas box thing that David's been talking about lately. The bottom line being that spiritual living is something that we ignore too much in our material lives. We come here to try to refocus on what our spiritual value is and how we work together spiritually. And yes, we're going through a period of what we're talking about with relationships now. But the idea behind relationships is spiritually our connection with each other so that we can join in one and be connected to you and have you with us and have you be our strength and to show you that we love you and that we honor and praise you every day of our life, every second. We work with that. Pastor Herbert has been offering extended study in the morning before service. And that is a wonderful thing to help us develop a deeper relationship with you, a greater understanding with you, because we are attacked. We are being constantly pelted in our material lives with an evil spirit. Spirits aren't always good. There are evil spirits also, and it is a war. And we need to battle every day as we need to stay pure, to stay connected to you, to do proper battle, to come out the winner, to be victorious, as Herb has said, over the evil forces, so that in your service, we may be able to be one in strength with you to conquer evil once and for all, so that everyone may be able to turn their eyes and their hearts and their love towards you, to live with you in an everlasting, joyful, peaceful, wonderful, loving life.
Lord, we summarize all this, Lord, by thank you again for her. And for his love for you first, because without that, he wouldn't have the love that he has so much of for us. And we pray that you continue to strengthen those ties. Lord, give him a sense of appreciation that even we can provide to him, but we know you can. In your name we pray. Amen. So Herb, this is really small, but gather a little bit for you, and on the subject of relationships, the one question I often ask my wife, and I get the question back, well, statement back, I often ask, where do you want to go out to eat? And the statement is, I don't care, which is not really a statement or a question, it's a how well do you know me sort of thing. So when we collected this, I did say that, you know, Sheila could take you out to eat, but I you want to give him a little grace here, Sheila, and help him out, and maybe tell him where you want to go. We love you, and we appreciate you. So.
Thank you for that wonderful prayer, and thank you, all of you, for your constant prayers, your encouragement. It is a privilege to be a part of a church where we're family, and we love each other and care each other, so thank you very much. Now I pray that God's Spirit, the one who filled Jesus, will fill you. That he'll give you a sense of his presence, his peace, but also direction, how you are to live this week with joy and strength, and that others will see Christ in you, be drawn to him, and that together you will be able to rejoice in the eternal home and the current home that we have. Now, let's go be the church.